Dear students, today we are going to discuss subject wise test MCQs of pharmacology, and we have very interesting questions lined up. I hope you all will enjoy and it will be a fruitful discussions. We'll start with question number 1, but before starting the questions, these questions have been selected based on the recent All India AIIMS and other autonomous institute questions. The pattern and the topics would reflect the similar kind of questions will appear in your exams. So these are questions which are based high yield questions. Yes, so we'll start with question number 1. As you can see, question number 1 is about Remeltion. Which of the following is not true? So we have 4 options given, and let's look at the explanation. So question number 1 is about Remeltion. First point, Remeltion is an agonist on melatonin 1 and melatonin 2 receptors. So it's not an antagonist, it's an agonist on melatonin receptor. Melatonin we all know is a hormone coming from pineal gland, and it maintains the circadian rhythm. So Remeltion will be used in conditions where the circadian rhythm is disturbed, like in jet lag disorders and day and night shift workers. So Remeltion, being an agonist at the melatonin receptor, is again used to reset the disturbed circadian rhythm, and this disturbing of circadian rhythm is seen in jet lag disorders and day and night shift workers. So these are two principal indications of this hormone Remeltion, which is an agonist on melatonin receptors. In its pharmacokinetic, the important point is CYP1A2. This is a microsomal enzyme CYP450. One of the CYP450 microsomal enzyme is CYP1A2. Remeltion is metabolized by this isoform CYP1A2. So it is important to remember that certain drugs like fluoxamine can inhibit this microsomal enzyme CYP1A2. Fluoxamine, you all will remember, is an SSRI. Fluoxamine can inhibit this microsomal enzyme CYP1A2, and that can result in increased levels of Remeltion because this enzyme is metabolizing Remeltion. Coming to side effects of Remeltion, number 1, what we need to remember, as such it has very mild side effects, but it can, since it is acting on circadian rhythm, it can affect hormonal levels. So certain hormones are again secreted based on circadian rhythm. So what it can do, it can decrease the testosterone level and increase levels of prolactin. So these are two side effects in hormonal levels which can be seen with Remeltion. So this is very important. And last and good thing, which is actually not a side effect but an important point to remember, is that it has minimal abuse liability. So Remeltion, we all need to remember, is a drug used for disorders of sleep, that is circadian rhythm disturbances like in jet lag disorders, and it has a minimal abuse liability. So that is a very important point. So minimal abuse liability, affecting the hormonal levels, decreasing testosterone, increasing prolactin, these are important side effects. Metabolism is by CYP1A2, which can be inhibited by drugs like fluoxamine, and remember, remeltion is an agonist on melatonin receptors. So if you look at the question, which of the following is not true? MT1 and MT2 receptor antagonist. This is a wrong answer, wrong option, and that will be the answer of this particular question. Question number 1, answer is option number A. It is not true. Remeltion is agonist, not antagonist. Moving on to question number 2. The diagram shows us question number 2. The given diagram shows us gum hypertrophy. Very important question these days because of the image based questions that are being asked increasingly. Simple questions. Some of the antiepileptics like phenytoin, valproate, and even barbiturates, they all can lead to gum hypertrophy. And therefore, the option, the correct answer to this particular question will be option number D. Question number 2, which of the following can result in the side effect shown below? The side effect shown is gum hypertrophy, and the answer will be option number D, all of the above. In this question, it is also sometimes important to focus on color of teeth. So when you are shown a diagram of mouth, focus on gums, whether it is showing gum hypertrophy, or focus on teeth. Teeth discoloration, remember, yellow staining of teeth, or sometimes they ask discoloration of enamel. This is a particular side effect of tetracyclines. Tetracyclines can cause yellow staining of teeth or discoloration of enamel. So in the questions where you are shown a diagram of the mouth, focus on gums, whether the question is trying to show you gum hypertrophy or whether the question is asking some abnormality in teeth. Two important abnormalities from pharmacology which are asked is gum hypertrophy and yellow staining of teeth. So yellow staining of teeth or discoloration of enamel is a property, is a side effect of tetracyclines, and gum hypertrophy, some of the important drugs causing gum hypertrophy would include phenytoin, valproate, and barbiturates, all the three antiepileptic drugs. Moving on, question number 3. Question number 3 says adjustment of drug dose is not required in cirrhosis of liver. So question is basically asking which of the following drugs are safe in patients of liver failure. That is a simple question which is being asked. So question number 3, benzodiazepines which are safe in liver failure, that is the question. Let's look at the first answers. There is a very simple mnemonic, LOTE, and it gives you lorazepam, oxazepam, temazepam, triazolam, and estazolam. These are the 5 important benzodiazepines which are safe in cases of liver failure. So frequently you are asked which benzodiazepines are safe in liver failure, or it can be asked which benzodiazepines are better for alcoholics. From alcoholic, we should again consider a state of liver failure. Similarly, sometimes they ask which benzodiazepines are safe in elderly. Again, we should consider in elderly there might be some hepatic compromise. So in all such questions, we have to consider these 5 benzodiazepines: lorazepam, oxazepam, temazepam, triazolam, and estazolam. And most commonly you will find these 3, the 3 written on the top, LOT, these are the ones which are given in the option. So these are the ones you are looking for in such questions. So adjustment of dose is not required for which of the following in liver failure? So answer will be lorazepam, option number A. Lorazepam does not require adjustment of dose in liver failure. Simple question. Moving on to question number 4. Drug useful in rehabilitation of alcoholic patients are following except. Following except. So let's look at alcohol de-addiction. Alcohol de-addiction. And what are the drugs useful? First of all, the first important drug is naltrexone. Naltrexone is an opioid antagonist. Opioid antagonist. It will decrease the release of dopamine in nucleus accumbens. Decrease the release of dopamine in nucleus accumbens, and this will decrease the pleasure, and slowly the craving is lost. So that is the mechanism of naltrexone. So this is the first drug used for alcohol de-addiction or rehabilitation of alcoholism. Second drug, second important drug after naltrexone is acamprosate. Acamprosate is basically an NMDA antagonist. The hash sign represents antagonism. NMDA, you all will remember, is a type of glutamate receptor. NMDA is a type of glutamate receptor that is blocked by acamprosate, again decreases the reward phenomena associated with drinking. Third drug is disulfiram. Disulfiram, I hope you all recognize this molecule, very popular in pharmacology. Sorry. Disulfiram is an inhibitor of aldehyde. Remember, aldehyde dehydrogenase. So disulfiram is an inhibitor of aldehyde dehydrogenase, also known as anti-abuse. So disulfiram inhibits aldehyde dehydrogenase, not alcohol dehydrogenase, and leads to accumulation of aldehyde, and that causes unpleasant symptoms. So the desire not to drink is reinforced. So there is an alcoholic who has decided that he wants to give up. He is motivated to give up. That patient can be put on disulfiram. If because of craving that subject drinks anytime, because he is taking disulfiram, there will be accumulation of aldehyde and he will have unpleasant symptoms like nausea, vomiting, hypertension. So his desire to give up alcohol, his desire not to drink will be reinforced. Instead of pleasure, after drinking alcohol, he got unpleasant symptoms. So he will think that I should not drink any further. So disulfiram, please remember, very, very important point, is useful only in motivated subjects. Motivated or determined, whatever term is given in the question, it is not useful for an alcoholic who is not determined or motivated to give up. So these are three important drugs which are used, approved for treatment of alcohol de-addiction: naltrexone, acamprosate, disulfiram. What are the other drugs which are used? Topiramate. It's an anti-epileptic drug which is also useful. Ondansetron, anti-emetic, 5-HT3 antagonist, that is also used. And third, you can write cannabinoid antagonist. There is one drug known as Ramona Bent, that was also used, but now this drug has been withdrawn from the market. So it's no longer available, but for the MCQ sake, we should remember that these are the other options which were available. Finally, investigational drugs, which are still being tried, no clear cut evidence, nalmefene. Again, another opioid antagonist which is being tried, baclofen. It's a muscle relaxant which is also being tried. So these are under investigations. Their place in treatment is still not defined. So these are the drugs which are used for treatment of alcoholism: naltrexone, acamprosate, and disulfiram. These are three important drugs. Besides this, in other drugs, remember topiramate, ondansetron, and cannabinoid receptor antagonist, rimonabant. It was used. Some of the other drugs which are being tried: nalmefene, another opioid antagonist, and baclofen. So if we look at the question, all of the following are used except, answer is very clear, answer will be option number B, varenicline. Varenicline is a drug useful in smoking cessation, not alcohol cessation, but smoking cessation. Varenicline is used for smoking cessation, and it is a partial agonist on nicotinic receptor. So varenicline, it's used for smoking cessation, not alcohol cessation, and it is a partial agonist on nicotinic receptor. It is the most effective drug for smoking cessation, varenicline. So that you should know, important drug varenicline, also used for smoking cessation, not for alcohol cessation. In smoking cessation, another important drug that you should remember would be bupropion. Bupropion, it's an antidepressant, and it is also used for smoking cessation. Moving on, question number 5. Drugs that can cause neuroleptic malignant syndrome include the following except. So again, except, always in MCQs, read the question carefully. Sometimes you may miss out in hurry on reading words like except, and you may commit error which may cost you 4 marks. So please read the questions very carefully. Which of the following can cause neuroleptic malignant syndrome? Except. So question number 5. See, in this question we should consider drug-induced hyperthermic syndromes, and there are 3 or 4 that we should know. First is malignant hyperthermia. Malignant hyperthermia, this is due to abnormality or mutations in rhinodine receptor. Rhinodine receptor is a calcium sensing receptor on sarcoplasmic reticulum. Patients who have abnormality in this rhinodine receptor may develop malignant hyperthermia on use of succinylcholine and particularly halothane. So succinylcholine and halothane and some other inhalational anesthetic gases, they may cause malignant hyperthermia. There is muscle rigidity and hyperthermia. The treatment of this condition, malignant hyperthermia, will be dantrolene sodium. Dantrolene sodium is the treatment. Malignant hyperthermia caused by succinylcholine and halogenated anesthetic gases. So in such cases, there will be a history of patient undergoing recent surgery, because succinylcholine, halothane, both are used during surgery. Second is called neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome, again there is muscle rigidity and hyperthermia. This condition is caused by number 1, D2 blockers, or what we call them first generation antipsychotic like haloperidol, chlorpromazine, these kind of drugs which block D2 receptors in CNS, extrapyramidal side effect. It can also be caused by other D2 blockers like metoclopramide, this also crosses blood-brain barrier and blocks D2 receptor in brain, that may also result in neuroleptic malignant syndrome. It may also be caused by some SSRIs like fluoxetine, and this may be caused by very important withdrawal, sudden withdrawal of dopaminergic agents, withdrawal of dopaminergic agents like amantadine. So either we block D2 receptors in brain or we withdraw the dopaminergic support to brain, both conditions will result in neuroleptic malignant syndrome. So D2 blockers, which are antipsychotic first generation, they may cause this. Metoclopramide, which is not an antipsychotic but has the same mechanism, D2 block it, they may also cause it. Fluoxetine is an SSRI which may cause, and withdrawal of dopaminergic agent, amantadine, which are used for Parkinson's, they may result in neuroleptic malignant syndrome. And again, the treatment of this condition is same as dantrolene sodium. So the treatment remains same, dantrolene sodium. Third kind of drug induced hyperthermia is called serotonin syndrome. As the name suggests, it's a condition where serotonin increases too much in our body. So again, there will be hyperthermia, and in addition to hyperthermia, there are now autonomic disturbances are there. Which drugs can cause serotonin syndrome? MAO inhibitors, SSRIs, tricyclic antidepressant, MAO inhibitors, SSRI, tricyclic antidepressant, lithium, tryptan is like sumatriptan, rizatriptan, they are drugs used for migraine treatment, they may also cause it. Then certain painkillers like pethidine, like tramadol, they may also result in serotonin syndrome. It is also a drug induced hyperthermic condition. Along with hyperthermia, now there is autonomic disturbances as well. MAO inhibitors, SSRIs, tricyclics, lithium, tryptans and pethidine, tramadol, these are some important drugs. Any drug which increases the level or action of serotonin directly or indirectly can precipitate serotonin syndrome. So MAO inhibitor property can lead to serotonin syndrome. The treatment is symptomatic, there is no drug of choice as of now. Cyproheptadine is a drug which is tried, which is used, but it has only modest improvement, it is not a very specific drug. And fourth is non-specific hyperthermia by drugs. And in this, important you should remember is amphetamines. One of the amphetamine which is abused is known as MDMA or ecstasy, commonly referred to as rave party drugs. So amphetamines, MDMA is a type of amphetamine, methyl deoxymethamphetamine, which is commonly known as ecstasy, they may cause hyperthermia. Atropine, you should know atropine, very important drug causing hyperthermia. LSD, phencyclidine, also known as PCP, phencyclidine, these are some other drugs which may cause non-specific hyperthermia, drug induced hyperthermia. So amphetamines, atropine, LSD, phencyclidine or PCP, they may cause body temperature to rise, hyperthermia. Serotonin syndrome, which is caused by any drug which increases serotonin levels, like MAO inhibitors, SSRI, tricyclics, other drugs. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome, which is caused mainly due to D2 blockade, which is most asked in the question, D2 blockade. So any antipsychotic first generation, metoclopramide, fluoxetine is an important drug to remember, and withdrawal of dopaminergic agents may result in neuroleptic syndrome. And first is malignant hyperthermia, which is caused by succinylcholine or halothane, that is also drug induced hyperthermia. So if you look at the question, I think the question is very clear now. Drugs that can cause neuroleptic malignant syndrome include the following except fluoxetine, as I've told you. Domperidone is also a D2 blocker, so there is a possibility. Molindone is again an antipsychotic D2 blocker. LSD does not cause neuroleptic malignant syndrome, it causes non-specific hyperthermia. So that is the answer of this particular question. Fifth question, answer is option number C, LSD. LSD causes non-specific hyperthermia, not neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Very important question. In one question, it is combining many questions, and you should, after reading the explanation, be able to answer some questions regarding serotonin syndrome, questions regarding malignant hyperthermia, and questions regarding neuroleptic malignant syndrome. Question number 6. Which of the following is most commonly used worldwide for maintenance therapy of opioid dependence? Out of the 4 options, the correct option will be option number C, methadone. Let's look at the explanation. Question number 6. Opioid de-addiction. There are 2 drugs which are used for maintenance treatment of opioid addiction or opioid de-addiction. Most important, most common is methadone. Methadone is most commonly used, and the second is a new drug, relatively new, buprenorphine. Buprenorphine. So this is known as methadone maintenance therapy, and this is known as buprenorphine maintenance therapy. So 2 drugs are used, methadone and buprenorphine. Methadone is most popular, and that is the answer to this question. Methadone maintenance therapy or buprenorphine maintenance therapy for opioid de-addiction. Methadone is a full agonist on mu receptor. Buprenorphine is a partial agonist on mu. This point is very important. Partial agonist on mu, that is number 1 point. Methadone is very slow and long acting. Slow and long acting. So there are 2 benefits of this particular property. Due to slow acting, it does not give kick. Is sudden pleasure on consumption of certain abusive substances. The substance which act very quickly, they provide sudden impact in CNS, and there is a kick or pleasure. Methadone, being a slow acting, does not provide the kick, so there is no chances of abuse of methadone, or minimal chances. And second, because of long duration of action, the withdrawal symptoms are mild. So what we will do, there is a subject who is addicted to heroin or opium. We will replace his heroin or opium with methadone. Methadone will stimulate the receptor as is full agonist on mu, but it is slow and long acting, so it will not provide any kick. So there is no chances of methadone being abused. And when we will stop methadone, after some time, the withdrawal symptoms that will come will be milder. So that is why methadone is used for de-addiction of opium. Second is BMT, as I have told you. Another is BMT, buprenorphine maintenance therapy. Buprenorphine, being a partial agonist, will stimulate the receptor, stimulate mu receptors submaximally, and will prevent sudden withdrawal symptoms. So again, buprenorphine can be used in places of methadone if required. That's a new upcoming therapy. So two therapies are used, methadone maintenance therapy and buprenorphine maintenance therapy. Other options in the question, naloxone is a mu antagonist, it's an opioid antagonist, it is given IV, very rapid acting, and it is used for treatment of opioid overdose or heroin poisoning, opium poisoning. Naloxone is used for that. It is not used for maintenance therapy, it is used for treatment of opioid overdose. So these are the other important option. Pethidine, I hope you all know. Option number D, pethidine is itself an opioid, no role in placement of no role in maintenance therapy of opioid dependence. So question number 6, correct option is option number C, methadone. Question number 7, fluoxetine causes all except. Fluoxetine is an SSRI. So the question is asking side effects of SSRI. The answer, the correct answer is option number C, sedation. Let's look at the explanation. Question number 7, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors side effects. So this question has been asked multiple times. Recently in 2018 AIIMS exam, the exam conducted last month, the same question was asked, only in place of fluoxetine the drug mentioned was citalopram. So they may write any particular SSRI, the topic remains the same, side effects of SSRI. First, most common side effect is nausea and vomiting, that's considered the most common. Diarrhea or loose stool, whatever is given in the options, is considered the second most common. So whatever, sometimes they ask you most common side effects, so whatever is given in the options, nausea, vomiting are considered most common, diarrhea or loose stool is second most common. So GIT side effects are the most common side effects in early therapy of SSRI. When we start the therapy, most of the subjects have GIT disorders like nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. Second, sexual side effects. What are these sexual side effects? Very important. Loss of libido and delayed orgasm. These are two important side effects. Now you remember, they are the most common side effects on long term therapy. So in chronic therapy, the GIT side effects will reduce, patient will develop some tolerance, but the sexual side effects will continue and they will be as high as 40% of the individuals receiving SSRI. So they are most common side effects on long term therapy. And what are these sexual side effects? Loss of libido and delayed orgasm. Particularly this delayed orgasm, this side effect can be used for treatment of premature ejaculation. Premature ejaculation, this side effect can be converted into a use. So SSRIs are also drug of choice for premature ejaculation. Third side effect of SSRI, CNS side effects. There are two important CNS side effects. One is insomnia, not sedation. They cause insomnia. So that is why the answer to this question is sedation all except. And second is anxiety. And anxiety, remember, is very common with particular SSRI known as fluoxetine. So fluoxetine has higher incidences of anxiety. So these are three side effects: GIT side effects, sexual side effects and CNS side effects. In this order these side effects appear. Fourth side effect can be withdrawal symptoms, or we also call as continuation syndrome. So basically there is a rebound depression. So there is a sudden stoppage of SSRI, patient may have rebound depression, also called as discontinuation syndrome or withdrawal symptoms. Now here it is important to remember that these are common with short acting SSRIs. So fluoxamine is the shortest, followed by paroxetine. It has a T half of approximately 20 hours, fluoxamine has T half of approximately 15 hours. So with fluoxamine and paroxetine, the discontinuation of withdrawal symptom is maximum seen with these drugs, and the symptom is minimally seen with fluoxetine, which is the longest acting drug in this category. So it has minimal withdrawal symptoms. This is the fourth side effect. Fifth side effect can be serotonin syndrome, which we have already discussed, so we will not discuss it again. They can cause serotonin syndrome by increasing serotonin. Sixth would be couple of side effects of paroxetine, which should be known. So paroxetine causes maximum weight gain. So all SSRIs increase weight, but the maximum increase is seen with paroxetine. So that is important. Second, highest sexual side effects. Sexual side effects are seen maximally again with paroxetine. So that's also important. And third, it is teratogenic. Very, very important. You can put a 2-star on this. Teratogenic, what it can do? It can cause pulmonary hypertension in newborn. If given to mother, the fetus or the newborn child may develop pulmonary hypertension. And secondly, it can cause cardiac septal defects. So cardiac septal defects can also be seen with paroxetine used during pregnancy. So just to summarize, SSRIs and their side effects are extremely important topic. Most common side effect is GIT side effect, nausea, vomiting and loose stools. Sexual side effects are most common side effect on long term therapy. Loss of libido and delayed orgasm are the two sexual side effects commonly seen. Premature ejaculation, as I have told you, it can be paroxetines, SSRIs can be used for treatment of premature ejaculation because of this side effect of delayed orgasm. CNS side effects include insomnia and anxiety, not sedation. Anxiety is particularly common with fluoxetine, remember. Withdrawal symptoms are common with short acting drugs. There are two short acting, fluoxamine followed by paroxetine. Fluoxetine is long acting, longest acting in this category, and has minimal side effects. Serotonin syndrome can be caused due to increase in serotonin levels, and paroxetine in particular has maximum weight gain, maximum sexual side effects and teratogenic. So you will find a lot of questions on SSRIs and the side effect. Question number 7 is a representative of all those questions. The answer is option number C, sedation. SSRIs cause insomnia, not sedation. Question number 8, buspirone. Buspirone, remember, is an anti-anxiety drug. So buspirone, as compared to benzodiazepines, question number 8, is more potent anticonvulsant, does not interfere with GABAergic transmission, COPD, can cause aphakia. So let's look at buspirone and try to understand what important points are there in buspirone. Question number 8. Buspirone, first of all, is an 5-HT1A partial agonist. So it's a partial agonist on 5-HT serotonin 1A receptor. Second point, it is used as anti-anxiety drug. Anti-anxiety, that is the second point. It's used as anti-anxiety. In anti-anxiety, it is important to remember it is a slow-acting drug. Effect will take approximately 1 week to appear, to reach its maximum. So, it is a slow-acting drug, and because it is a slow-acting drug, it is not useful for panic attacks. It's not useful for panic attacks because it's slow acting. That is the second point. 5-HT, 1A partial agonist. Third, it has minimal abuse liability. Unlike benzodiazepines, which are having high abuse liability, this drug has minimal abuse liability. So these are three important points in buspirone. So we can see, out of the given options, option number B is correct answer. It does not interfere with GABAergic transmission. So, as I have told, buspirone acts on serotonin receptor, not GABAergic receptor. So, that is the correct answer. It is an anti-anxiety, not anti-convulsant. So, option number A is wrong, and other options are irrelevant. Buspirone, correct answer is, does not interfere with GABAergic transmission. So, 3 points important in buspirone. It is a drug acting on serotonin receptor, not GABA receptor, 5-HT, 1A partial agonist. Second, it is a slow acting anti-anxiety, and because it is slow acting, it is not useful for treatment of panic attacks. And third point, it has minimal abuse liability, unlike benzodiazepines. So, that is about question number 8. Question number 9. Very important question nowadays. Many times it has been asked directly or indirectly in recent All India and AIIMS exam. Question number 9. A 25-year-old woman has a long history of depressive symptoms accompanied by body aches. Physical and laboratory tests are unremarkable. Which of the following drugs might be useful in this particular patient? So, what is question asking? Question number 9. Question is asking about treatment of a condition known as fibromyalgia. What is fibromyalgia? There is chronic musculoskeletal pain. Chronic musculoskeletal pain. There is fatigue. These are two important complaints, but there are no objective signs of inflammation like fever, like redness or erythema, like increased in ESR. No objective signs of inflammation are present. And lab tests are mostly normal. And this condition, fibromyalgia, this is typically seen in a woman aged between 20 to 50 years of age. So, a woman patient presenting in her mid 30s, 20 to 50, between mid 20 and 50, so we will take mid 30s, comes with complaints of chronic body ache. So, a generalized body ache along with fatigue, but the objective signs of inflammation are absent. Lab tests are almost normal. The condition can be diagnosed as fibromyalgia. For treatment of fibromyalgia, number one, SNRIs, selective norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors like milnacipran, preferred over duloxetine. These are two SNRIs, milnacipran, duloxetine, they are preferred in this order. Then tricyclic antidepressants like amitriptyline, it can also be used, and drugs like pregabalin or gabapentin. So these are three classes of drugs which are generally used in treatment of fibromyalgia in this order. SNRIs are considered preferred or drug of choice. Within SNRI, milnacipran is considered best, then duloxetine. If SNRIs are not given in the option, go for tricyclic antidepressant like amitriptyline. If nothing else is given, then look for options like pregabalin or gabapentin. So in the question we are given, let's look at the question again. There is a 25-year-old woman. So the patient is sitting in our typical case history, middle-aged woman, long history of depressive accompanied by body aches. Physical and lab tests are unremarkable. There is a diagnosis to be made of fibromyalgia, and for fibromyalgia we are looking for SNRI. We look in the option, fluoxetine, sertraline are SSRI. Duloxetine, option number D, is an SNRI, and that will be the answer to this question. So question number 9, option number D. Moving further, question number 10, tolcapone. True about tolcapone. So what is tolcapone? So tolcapone is a COMT inhibitor. That is number one point. COMT stands for catechol ortho methyl transferase. COMT. So catechol ortho methyl transferase inhibitor, tolcapone. Number one point. It inhibits COMT enzyme in periphery also and CNS also. So there are two sites of action of tolcapone. Second, inhibition of COMT increases the CNS penetration of levodopa, that is the second point. By inhibiting COMT enzyme, we can make the levodopa increase CNS penetration. Third, it is added to levodopa plus carbidopa combination. So there is a drug called Starlevo, it's a trade name. It consists of levodopa plus carbidopa plus a COMT inhibitor. So these three drugs are used in treatment. It should be quite obvious, in Parkinson's first we will use levodopa only with carbidopa. If the disease is not responding or progressing despite this treatment, then we will add COMT inhibitor. So these are add-on drugs for treatment of advanced disease, advanced Parkinson's. So they are not first line treatment or initial treatment, they are add-on drugs for advanced diseases. The combination becomes triple combination now. There are two COMT inhibitors which are available in market. First is called entacapone, and the second one is called tolcapone. Entacapone inhibits COMT only in periphery, and tolcapone, as I have told you, has in CNS also and periphery also, two sites of action. Simple to remember, tolcapone has two, so it will have two sides of action, but two can also remind of more toxic, and that is hepatotoxic. So main problem with tolkapone is hepatotoxicity. So tolkapone acts in periphery also and CNS also. It is hepatotoxic and it is a COMT inhibitor. 3 points, if we could remember, we can solve such questions. Question number 10, true about tolkapone. It's renal toxicity, no, it has hepatotoxicity. COMT inhibitor, correct. Does not cross blood brain barrier, that is wrong. I have told you it is acting in CNS also. So the answer will be option number B, COMT inhibitor. Moving on to question number 11. Compared to other antidepressant drugs, mirtazapine has distinct ability to act as antagonist of. So question number 11 is asking mirtazapine is sometimes referred to as NASA. All antidepressants have been referred to as some mnemonic. What is NASA? It stands for NA selective serotonergic agent. That is the mnemonic given. How does it act? What is the mechanism of action? It is acting via antagonism of presynaptic autoreceptors. Like alpha 2. So just to give you a diagrammatic idea, this is a neuron which has whether norepinephrine or 5-HT stored in it, presynaptic neuron. This is the synaptic space, and there are postsynaptic receptors, whether alpha or 5-HT, whatever receptor are there, alpha 1, alpha 2, whatever. This is the location of presynaptic receptor like alpha 2, and what these presynaptic receptors are doing, they are decreasing, inhibiting the neurotransmitter release. So alpha 2 is a presynaptic receptor. It decreases neurotransmitter release. So by blocking alpha 2 presynaptic, so if this receptor is blocked by drug called mirtazapine, this break on NA release is stopped and there is increase in neurotransmitter release, and this relieves depression. So mirtazapine blocks the presynaptic autoreceptor alpha 2. Blockade of presynaptic autoreceptor increases the neurotransmitter release like NA and serotonin, and this is used for treatment of depression. So mirtazapine is an alpha 2 blocker, anti depressant, and it is highly sedative drug. So it is good drug for patients, depressive patient having difficulty in sleeping, So mirtazapine is an alpha 2 blocker, causes blockade of presynaptic alpha 2, increases neurotransmitter release, that has antidepressant effects, and it is a highly sedative drug. So it is good for a depressive patient who is having difficulty in falling asleep. And fourth point in depression, mirtazapine, you can remember, it has minimal sexual side effects. So, couple of questions ago, we discussed SSRIs, antidepressants, and on chronic therapy, SSRIs have the most important problem of sexual side effects. So, very commonly you are asked this question, which antidepressants have minimal sexual side effect? Mirtazapine is one of them. So, minimal side effects in sexual nature, but highly sedative drug. So, question number 11, answer will be alpha 2, option C. Option C, alpha 2 blocker, mirtazapine. Question number 12, SSRIs are much less effective than tricyclics in management of. Much less effective than tricyclic. SSRIs versus tricyclics. Question number 12. Answer is option number B, neuropathic pain. But let's discuss how SSRIs differ from tricyclic. So, this is SSRI and this is tricyclic antidepressant. So, SSRIs have decreased risk of seizure, decreased risk of arrhythmia, and decreased anticholinergic side effects. So, all these three side effects are less with SSRIs. So, their better side effect profile is better than tricyclics. They have decreased risk of seizure, arrhythmia and other anticholinergic side effects as compared to tricyclics. Second point, SSRIs have quick onset of antidepressant effect. As compared to tricyclics, they act quickly. So, that is another advantage. They are more effective or more useful than tricyclics for a variety of conditions, more effective for anxiety disorder, for obsessive compulsive disorder. More effective, greater effectiveness is seen for anxiety, for obsessive compulsive disorder, then post traumatic stress disorder, then for eating disorders like bulimia nervosa, not anorexia, but bulimia nervosa, they are more effective. Then for premenstrual dysphoric syndrome. So, for all these conditions, SSRIs are more effective. And sixth, you can write, they are considered drug of choice, first line drug for depression treatment. Although efficacy wise, they are less than tricyclic, but because side effect profile is better, we consider them first line drug for depression. So, SSRIs are preferred drug now for depression, not more effective. But they are highly effective for anxiety, OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder, post traumatic stress disorder, eating disorders like bulimia and premenstrual dysphoric syndrome. They have less chances of seizure, less chances of arrhythmia and less anticholinergic side effect. These are advantages of SSRIs over tricyclics. Coming to tricyclics, tricyclics have less risk of or less incidences of sexual side effects and weight gain. As compared to SSRIs, tricyclics cause a lot of side effects but not sexual side effects, decreased incidences of sexual, and weight gain is also less with tricyclics. And they are greater effective, more effective for, number one, we will say, neuropathic pain. So neuropathic pain, pain which occurs along the course of a nerve, like in sciatica, like post herpetic neuralgia, like in diabetic neuropathy. Tricyclics are more effective than SSRIs. Similarly, they are greater effective for fibromyalgia than SSRIs. So these are two conditions, and third is severe depression. Severe or resistant depression, again tricyclics are more effective than SSRIs. So for these conditions, tricyclics are better. For other condition, mild depression, normal depression and anxiety and other disorders, SSRIs are better. So if we look at the question, SSRIs are less effective than tricyclics in management of, answer is very simple, answer is option number B, chronic pain of neuropathic origin. For bulimia, anxiety disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder, SSRIs are preferred over tricyclics. So the question is asking differences in tricyclics and SSRIs. The question is asking uses of tricyclics and SSRIs. And the question is asking the understanding of these two drugs. So remember, SSRIs and tricyclics, both are effective for treatment of depression. But tricyclics have a lot of anticholinergic and anti-alpha, anti-adrenergic blockade, lot of side effects. SSRIs have much better side effect profile. They cause less seizure, less arrhythmia, and they have quick onset of antidepressant action. These are the two reasons why tricyclics are less preferred than SSRIs for treatment of normal depression. Question number 13, lithium has been used with success in treatment of following except. So again, focus on the question, except is written in the end. So what are the uses of lithium? Let's look at question number 13, I guess 13 it is, yes, and it is asking uses of lithium. So we'll stick to uses only in this question. Number one, acute mania. Lithium can be used, but it is not the drug of choice for acute mania. Lithium, remember, has a slow onset of action. So it is given in acute mania, but it is not the drug of choice. Other drugs are also used which are more effective, including atypical antipsychotics like olanzapine, quetiapine, then benzodiazepines like lorazepam and valproate. They are also used for treatment of acute mania.